During the communist era, it was like that every 7th of November, the anniversary of the revolution. After the demonstration, people met again to listen to the speeches given by the party officials at the factory, but also to have a good time. Today is an important day for Ludmilla, the manager, an important day for the Zil factory veterans like Nikolai Kazakov. It is a big day for everyone, but for other reasons this time. They are not here to celebrate the revolution, but the 60th anniversary of Zil's Arts Palace, a kind of huge cultural center for the factory. For the last 60 years, the employees of the Zil automobile factory spent all their spare time here, for the worst as for the better. Everybody has been invited. All those who count and have counted for the factory. This is the case for Kalner, the general director of a great institute for gas research. In 1990, Kalner was the deputy manager for Zil. We had met him in 1990. We wanted to film the factory. Kalner was a rather difficult person to handle.
When would you like to start shooting?
Tomorrow, or the day after tomorrow. We still must meet people to prepare it. After that, the ideas will come along with it. So, to give you an exhaustive list of all the areas we'd like to shoot, we have to visit them, meet those in charge, and ask them what we can shoot and what we can't.
We can have you see everything. The problem is that the factory is under construction. Do you like to invite people over to your house when it's being cleaned?
We simply ask you to show us the areas that are presentable, those we can film. We can't make the list before seeing them.
It is precisely for that reason I asked you and the young man, I repeat, to write it down for me in black and white.
One had the impression that you were afraid of something at that time.
No, I was not afraid of anything. But I simply had certain obligations. They were the rules of the game at the time. Today, by the way, I still have obligations. I'm working on subject matters which are not necessarily open to the public, and I must keep silent. I'm under obligations to my bosses. It's another question to know whether those rules were unreasonable. Maybe they were, maybe they weren't, but I had accepted them. I signed the contract, so I have worked within the limits fixed by those rules. And when those rules no longer suited me, I left Zil, although those rules had become more flexible.
In 1990, Zil, as elsewhere in Russia, began to adopt a market economy. Just take a guess at how the factory's marketing manager felt about it.
Now we must go back to the sources of Leninism and rethink it. We must revise what provision the doctrine made for a case of that kind. Check, for example, if the adoption of a market economy is not in contradiction with Leninism. We are not refusing the market as long as it respects social welfare, which is the very essence of the revolution.
You think that the answer to the market lies in Lenin's work?
Yes, I do think that. We must look to him for the answer.
If tomorrow ZIL was privatized, what would you do?
I'd leave ZIL immediately.
Where would you go?
I don't know. I'd take up farming. I'd go plant cabbage.
ZIL was privatized, but the manager is still there. In 1998, he refused to see us. The factory was privatized in 1992. Until then, things went the following way. The state government fixes the country's annual lorry supply need. After a short negotiation with the trade unions, a negotiation which barely changes anything, ZIL would start manufacturing the full number of lorries, if possible. Moreover, when the new private owners took a look at the factory, the workshop schedules turned topsy-turvy. The capitalist process was carried out to the letter, everything the communist propaganda had been combating for years. The shock was tremendous. The most outmoded equipment was used down to the last thread, and employees were let go with incredible brutality. As a result, production decreased from 100,000 vehicles to 20,000 in 1996, and the manpower decreased from 60,000 to 15,000 employees. In early 1997, ZIL was on the edge of bankruptcy.
In 1917, we had a slogan, "Let's do it, then we'll see." In order to privatize, we used the same slogan, "Let's do it and see what we get." With giants like ZIL, we could not proceed that way. We could do it with a hairdresser's shop, but not with ZIL.
In that deal, ZIL almost disappeared. A takeover bid by the Korean Daewoo was even seriously discussed. But during the last few months, things got better. The slump was stopped and confidence regained. The little miracle had a name, Yuri Lushkov, ZIL's new boss. Yuri Lushkov is the head of the very powerful Moscow government. He is one of the men considered to become Boris Yeltsin's prime minister. A pure product of Communist Party leadership like Boris Yeltsin, Lushkov experienced the same dazzling rise to power. The rebirth of Moscow as an active and dynamic city is due to him. The modernization, the renovation and embellishment of the city is also due to him. Companies in trouble especially appeal to him. That is how ZIL, mortally wounded by privatization, placed blind faith in him. Through Lushkov, ZIL was entrusted to the state, which had again taken control of the company. Today, the government of Moscow holds 54% of ZIL's shares.
Democracy is good for social life, man's freedom of conscience. But in economy, we need dictatorship. Dictatorship by money, dictatorship by management, by the manager, dictatorship by those who have taken on responsibilities and must meet their commitments.
The first consequences of Lushkov's arrival was the return to the foreground of Zil's former secretary general of the party, Vladimir Nosov. At the time, he told us that Lushkov stated that to him, the main point was not to be a party member, the most important thing was professional proficiency and human qualities. It was for those qualities and others that Valery Nosov, Vladimir's brother, became general manager in 1996. Today, he presides over a board of directors, among whom numerous former ZIL executives were called back. Valery Nosov also worked at ZIL before leaving to rebuild the company in bankruptcy. Today, back in his stomping grounds, he is being asked to do the same job for ZIL. In order to achieve this, he can rely on his brother's influential friends made at the time when Vladimir Nosov was party secretary at the factory and ruled over 28,000 militants. The role of Moscow's government was essential in the changes made at ZIL. Of course, ZIL was still privatized, but the 54% of shares held by the city have brought back confidence.
Псковский завод, выполнение ноября 110% по товару и за 11 месяцев 71%. Рославский завод, ноябрь 91%, 11 месяцев 83%.
Если в начале года акция стоила наши полтора доллара...
At the beginning of the year, one share was worth a dollar and a half, now it is worth $30.
Рязанский завод 81%, ноябрь месяц 101%, 11 месяцев. Уральский завод 73% за ноябрь месяц, 68% 11 месяцев. И завод...
So does it pay to be one of ZIL's shareholders?
It not only pays, it is especially a good choice, I think.
What do you mean by that?
The shareholders have become richer both materially and morally because they have taken ZIL as a partner.
Personnel office is a sign of ZIL's revival. Not long ago, people would run away from the factory, and it late paid low wages and sometimes paid in merchandise. The least we can say is that people were not rushing in to get a job here. Today, everything has changed. People aren't lining up at the door, but almost. There are those who are coming for the first time, and there are the regulars, those who left when ZIL was on the edge of bankruptcy and now are timidly starting to nose their way back in. This is the case of one of them who has come this morning for a job interview. The head of personnel welcomes him into his office. He was the former number two man party member at ZIL.
Nikola Borisovich, you are coming back to ZIL. You've already worked at the factory. When was that?
In 1973. From 73 to 94 in the first milling machine workshop. Fifth grade.
And why did you leave the factory?
Why did people leave the factory? People left the factory for different reasons. Personally, the wages no longer suited me.
I hope you're not only coming back for 2 or 3 months. We are adults, aren't we? Were you offered the same job?
I've already spoken with the workshop controller. We spoke several times on the phone. I've been asked to come back to the same spot on the same machines.
I can therefore consider that you are expected at the workshop.
Yes, I believe so. It should be settled.
Thanks a lot. Good luck.
That is for the good side of things, but there is another side. If today's wages are better than yesterday's, all the material advantages which changed the workers' lives and made ZIL a showcase of socialism and its workers, the system's privileged ones, all those benefits have now disappeared. As a result, the elite workers who left the factory at the crucial time of the crisis are not rushing back. The management has a difficult time finding the 5,000 skilled workers required to meet its output objectives. Meanwhile, young military draftees work for free at ZIL. As for young workers, they have quite a different version than that of the factory's management.
It's really a scandal. I'm going to stop working with you. I'm looking for someone for your interview, and you take advantage of it to interview with someone else.
What do you do at ZIL? Project design?
No, I do models.
Are you going to stay at the factory?
I don't know. We'll see.
We're not paid regularly.
What are your wages?
1 million rubles.
Is that the base salary at the factory?
No, I don't think so.
And will you continue your career at the factory?
Sure. To tell the truth, not really.
I see a lot of big industrial companies with a lot of ordinary people who are at the threshold of misery and poverty. It is hard for me to talk about it. Those people are guinea pigs for a large-scale experiment that is being totally improvised. In the past, it was better.
What do you mean by better?
Well, anyway, my father believes it was better. The system's organization was better. Even trivial things. For example, after work, workers could rest. They could spend their leisure time here. They had access to a sauna, could play sports. Now all that is over.
Our people are very interesting. They vote for liberty, democracy. For the market, they understand it's a different system. Not a socialist one, but a capitalist. But as soon as it reaches their well-being, they turn to their boss or their chief to ask for free housing. And he must answer, "Why free? Now we have to pay for it." And they complain, "What? Why must we pay for housing, pay for medical care, for education, schooling, studies? But why?" 8 years later, they can't get used to this new life. The workers remember. They say, before we had the socialist emulation, and why not restore it? Perhaps not on the same scale, Today, we have restored the socialist emulation by designating the best workers according to their work area. We have best worker lists. The workers themselves asked for it. You must have noticed the main corridor where there is a bulletin board with the photos of the best workers. All that is being restored, and it is mainly the trade union that takes care of it.
Коллектива автозаводцев, доблестным трудом прославившему родной завод, вручена почетная грамота ВЦСПС. Тридцать лет социалистического соревнования. В такие даты перед нами встает все величие пройденного пути. В 1929 году 16-я Всесоюзная партийная конференция приняла решение о широком развертывании соцсоревнования.
Do you know what society you're living in today?
We don't have a society. We only have discussions about it, especially in the upper circles of power. Today, people are asking the country's leaders just what kind of society are we building? What can they expect? That has not been defined yet. We have refused the old society, we have not defined the new one. We talk about old capitalism, new capitalism, the leaders don't say anything officially. We have no idea what society we're moving towards. The people are asking questions that are not being answered. That silence worries them.
Zil's Arts Palace meant the right to happiness at a time when happiness was rare. Today, it is what remains when everything else has disappeared. The 60th anniversary is not only a celebration, it is also the opportunity to find again one's landmarks in life.
I would like to congratulate everybody once again. Congratulate once again the manager of the Arts Palace and wish them a lot of success. Both of us, we have grown up together. It makes us realize that we're not getting any younger. Well, I wish you a lot of success.
Valery Borisovich pointed out an interesting fact. 20 years ago, there was a table on this stage, and behind that table, there were two very pleasant men. One of them was Vladimir Nosov. The other one was the youngest and the most handsome. He was the head of the editing workshop. His name was Valery Nosov. Here at the Arts Palace, we are a united family. The people behind me are devoted to their cause. Here on the stage, you can see our golden assets. Here with us tonight are people who dedicated their lives and their souls. They gave their absolute best to the men at Zil.
Людям.
At one point in their lives, Zeal workers and their sons spent time at the Arts Palace. After work, they could find here what they could not find elsewhere in the Soviet society if one did not belong to a big group like Zil. In the Soviet society, Zil's workers were rather privileged. They were the old system's most faithful units. They are certainly those who have lost the most over these last years in Russia. Despite the changes, Ludmila, their boss, has kept her position. She supports them through hard times. She shares their doubts and does her best to accompany them into the new world.
People who have spent their entire lives working, who have sacrificed their lives, their health is really irreproachable. We can only envy them, envy their enthusiasm. Maybe their ideas were erroneous, but they strongly believed in them. They were their ideals. Unfortunately, we're lacking in ideals today. This is probably why people are turning to religion, because they need to believe in something.
A pope walking in the very secular Arts Palace. This scene symbolizes the complete turnabout of ideas in Russia. Every week, in the same rooms, which long served to advocate atheism, the neighborhood children can now attend Father Valery's classes on divine law. An incredible quiet revolution carried out by Ludmila, the head of the Arts Palace.
It's our culture. It is our life. I don't know how to explain it to you. It is absolutely necessary for our children. They must learn about it. It doesn't do them any harm. On the contrary, it teaches children respect. Respect towards parents, respect towards adults. It's very important. I am all for it. Religion has always been essential for people. Our generation did not have that opportunity. Children should know the religion a little better.
Let's do a short flashback to understand why these scenes of those children in the classrooms are revolutionary. Sixty years ago, on the present location of the Arts Palace, there was that monastery, the Smolny Monastery, one of the most beautiful in Moscow. An important Orthodox community lived here until that one day in 1937 when the Bolsheviks decided to eliminate all trace of the former system. In Moscow alone, 400 churches were destroyed. The operation was carried out during the Communist Saturdays. Volunteers, in squads, Zil's workers turned the monastery into ruins. Then, with the ruins of the cemetery, they built Zil's Arts Palace, which better suited the aesthetics of the new times. For nearly 60 years, this community hall was where party meetings took place, as if to erase history from memory, eliminating all former beliefs and inventing new ones. For nothing. Like Ludmila says today, we've been walking on the dead for too long. We mustn't do any more harm here.
Amen.
знамени Божьей Матери, та в Казанской Божьей Матери, тут Петра и Павла.
Сам Господь по неисповедимым своим промыслам устраивает так.
God himself, for unknown reasons, sees to it that what is created by the world only lasts through a definite space of time.
Отрезок.
Nothing lasts. Everything comes to an end.
Так что тут победы. Если она и есть,
if there be victory in the ordinary sense of the word, it is not man's victory, but the victory of the holy way.
A few hundred yards from the Arts Palace is another sacred place. Another symbol of the ancient world, like the monastery, but not destroyed by the Bolsheviks. Enshrined in the factory's territory, it is the Church of the Assumption of the Virgin, founded in the 14th century. Here, in 1937, Bolsheviks did not pull down the walls. They were satisfied enough by looting the works of art and the furniture to replace them with Zill's compressors. And then, at the beginning of the 90s, times changed. Compressors were removed. The church was restored, and the faithful came from everywhere, from Zill especially, as if they had always been there. Including the vandals' hires, die-hard communists such as Ludmilla only had to take a few steps to find themselves in church once again.
Life willed that I should know Father Vladimir. Father Vladimir is an extraordinary person. He is the patron saint of the Church of the Assumption of the Virgin. At the beginning, he interested me as a character, not necessarily as a priest. And then I experienced great misfortune in my life. It's difficult for me to talk about it. My husband died overnight. I was very distraught. And Father Vladimir helped me a lot. There is something about these people. He succeeded in shaking me out of my distress at that time, in convincing me that that was the way things were and that life must go on. And it's true that it soothes one to go to church. I can light a candle. I can come closer to the icon. I can talk about my misfortunes, my pain, my illnesses.
Господи помилуй, Господи помилуй, Господи помилуй.
Люди прежде всего хотят утешения.
First of all, what people want is consolation and protection, and that is natural. What does a child expect from his mother? He first wants protection and maternal warmth. Who comes to church seeks protection against the surrounding darkness of life.
Since the party does not have an answer to everything, people at Zill are confused. After having been the guinea pigs of that new communist religion which tried to eradicate the old one, they must now pay and shamelessly accept their defeat in the face of the victor.
Lenin did not only do a cultural revolution, he also turned people's souls upside down. Today, look around you, faces, looks have changed. To do it right, people's souls should be turned upside down again. But for that, we would need a new leader, and if not a leader, at least a divine force to change the human soul.
When you are 92 years old like Nicholas Kazakov, when you have been a communist since the age of 15, and when you have destroyed with your own hands the Smolny Monastery to replace it with the Arts Palace, it is difficult to think that throughout your life you have not seen the world as you should have. So you do not say it. Like Ludmilla, you go to church again without repudiating anything, pretending that the destruction of the monastery was merely an accident along the way, and that between God and Lenin, true love exists.
The communists have always tried to draw people through humanistic values without showing their true colors, the devil's colors. They praised the laws of Moses, and the Ten Commandments even became the code of morals of the communist builders. Actually, communist values and Christian values are contradictory. Only false pretenses can make you believe that they are the same thing. Seen from the outside, twins can look alike, when actually one is a saint and the other a criminal.
That day, Father Valery plays the saint and Nicholas Kazakov plays the devil.
We communists believe that we should do our utmost to prevent Russia from being slaughtered. Everything is conspiring towards our loss. One doesn't want Russia to be born again. We communists believe that it is our duty to fight against those conspirators. We're trying to explain to the people that we must first break away from that power.
Another revolution?
No, not a revolution. Democratically.
We should build the church inside us. We still have too much passion, too many sins. Yes, sins. We condemn others, but me, for example, I am a sinner. I never stop sinning. And why should I blame Yeltsin? I'm myself an abyss full of sins. I should start on myself. I am Russia. Inside me there is no working order yet. Russia is in me. So I should set a more modest task for myself. I must first put myself in order.
But we both have a God. Our gods are just different.
No, God, there is only one God. Well, if you start saying that, I quit. Lenin is something different. Lenin is not God.
What I mean is that while Father Valery struggles against himself, Russia is dying. We communists, as we struggle against ourselves, are also trying to save our country.
Well, let's work together.
Yes, we must do something.
We must always do something. Faith without action is obviously a dead end.
По-моему, я уже сказал о том, что
All right, I think I have been quite clear. The party has acknowledged that it took very tough measures toward the church and that its positions were erroneous. We presently believe that the Bible's essential commandment and the main ideas of communism go well together. We should work together to restore the people's morals. Do you agree?
Yes, but what is the essential commandment? It is the love of God and the love for one's neighbor. For the rest, yes, in fact, there are things that are similar with communism. But you must not forget the essential. He forgets. He's a good politician.
Regarding God, for a lot of people, for me too personally, God obviously does not exist.
That's your point of view, and you are nothing but a poor little human being.
Yes, but if faith, if belief in God makes man become more honest and fair, well, that's already a start.
A few hundred yards from there, in the factory, is another situation just as unusual. That day, we tested the last bell coming from the workshop, and Valerie Nosov could all the more appreciate the results, since it took a long time to achieve that. A few years earlier, his predecessors at the head of the company had decided to add the manufacturing of bells to that of lorries in order to meet a promising market. Churches and cathedrals were springing up a bit everywhere throughout the country. To do a good job, a genuine communist was asked to develop that market.
The act of manufacturing bells today is very symbolic. We did not only appeal to Zill's technologies, we did new research. We fused the old and the new to prove that Zill's scientific and technical potential is still very important. We proved not only that Zill could produce cars, but also could create musical instruments.
It still took a long time to get it right. At the beginning, a first bell exploded, then a second one, until the manager, for lack of technical explanation, decided to ask the Pope's advice concerning his own baptism. He then discovered that he had quickly been baptized by his mom during World War II and got properly baptized. That, however, did not suffice. Other communist workers did the same. They even invited the priests to bless the melting forges, where some said the melting metals were cursed. And it was only from the moment when the workshop was in unison with God that the bell stopped breaking. At least, that was the rumor in the factory. Large-scale production really only started from that time on.
The Patriarch of Moscow and of all Russia, Alexis II, has blessed the place where heavy bells are manufactured. He fully recognized the workers who are involved in the manufacturing of the bells. He rewarded them all with honors and medals conferred by the Russian Orthodox Church.
Все работающие были награждены медалями
All the workers have received the medals from St. Daniel of Moscow, St. Seraph of Saros. I myself received the Order of St. Daniel.
In the presence of Father Vladimir, now Zeal's priest, the workers' names were carved on all the bells, especially those ready to be pulled up onto the top of Saint-Sauveur Cathedral. This ceremony, entirely filmed by Zeal's audiovisual service, is somehow the resume of the rebirth of Moscow's cathedral, which was pulled down by Stalin in the 30s to build a swimming pool in its place. 60 years later, the pool has been destroyed in turn and the Saint-Sauveur Cathedral has re-emerged, thanks to the determination of one man, Lushkov, Moscow's mayor, present owner of Zil, which manufactures bells.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost, may the bell be blessed and sanctified by the grace of the Holy Spirit, by this holy water in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
The resurrection of the Saint-Sauveur Cathedral is also the result of patrons and sponsors living in the capital who wanted to re-identify themselves after years of amnesia. To make this identical symbol be reborn on the same spot, everyone responded fervently and generously to the public subscription launched by the head of the Moscow government.
His Holiness, under your leadership, we will be able to do a lot for Moscow. And not only for Moscow, but for Russia too. Thank God for this period we are living. A difficult and uncertain period, when a lot of things are confused, chaotic, when a lot of things are not as we wish they were. You, our Holiness, at the head of the Orthodox Church, thank God you soothe our anxiety and despair in our souls and in our minds. You guide our souls in the right direction for Russia.
Do you think it was a good thing to build that cathedral again?
Globally speaking, yes. But it wasn't worth hurrying, so. Our country is in such a state of dilapidation. We could have used the money to boost our economy, at least. Everything is in ramshackles and we're practically on the verge of total collapse. This has been a concerted policy, not one of errors.
as traditional Russia, that of Kazakov, Ludmilla, and the Nosovs, get ready to turn in for the night. Another Russian night is just beginning. It's Anton's Russia, Kazakov's grandson. For him, as for thousands of young Moscovites who have been partying now for several years every Saturday night, the night will be long. Anton, how do you see yourself 10 years from now?
Let's transpose that into today's world. An interesting job with a wage of a few thousand dollars, a wife, and a kid maybe. I can tell you that Che Guevara glory does nothing for me.
All of that is not very exciting. Don't you want something else? That's a rather cushy little life, isn't it?
Yes, for others maybe. I would like to have a normal, regular life. Disorder and perversion I'll keep for my private life.
Try to make another film, Daniel. Bring much more money than last time, or you're gonna blow. $100 bill is not impressive anymore. I'll explain why next time.